Hey, what's up, everybody? This is your boy Kenny, and this is Queen Sugar Season 1, Episode 10, and the name of this episode is So Far. Now, the episode opens up with Kiki and Micah. Kiki's a cheerleader, and Micah is watching her cheer. The next thing you know, we actually see them interact with each other. You can definitely tell there's some chemistry there, and they're flirting back and forth, and it's really cute to see. It's like, you know, young love. But on the other hand, though, I am on the fence a little bit because it's making me question, does Kiki have an ulterior motive as to why she's talking to Micah? Because she's constantly bringing up, well, her friend said this about him, her friend said that about him. So it's making me question, are you with him because of who he is, being Davis West's son, or are you really into Micah for Micah? And I hope she's really into Micah for Micah, because Micah has been through a lot, and you can definitely tell he's still going through it in regards to the situation. So I really hope that she's really into Micah for Micah, and that she's not another person looking to take a ride off of him. So, definitely keep that in mind. Next, we actually see Nova and Chantal. Nova's making breakfast, you know, because they obviously had a good night. It was obvious because Chantal pretty much just had on, like, this little top, and baby, her ass was all out. So, Nova and her had a good time. So, she's making breakfast for, and Nova is about to do an interview with a big mainstream personality. I forgot the name of the lady though. But next thing you know, Chantal just starts involving herself, and she starts becoming very aggressive, saying that, oh yeah, we need to talk about Black Lives Matter. You need to develop talking points. Oh yeah, you should talk about this and you should bring up that. And Nova is starting to peep it like, what's your aim, bitch? Are you trying to submerge yourself into this process, or are you just trying to help? You know, so Nova's kind of on the fence right now because she's kind of peeping her like, girl, you really doing a hell of a lot right now. But in the meantime, won't you eat your food while it's still hot? So that was like Nova letting me know, like, bitch, I'm on to you. So, yeah, we're going to see what goes on with that, you know, later on in the show. Next, we actually see that the family meets up. Ralph, Angel, Charlie, Proctor, who's the farm manager, Nova, and I'm by. And she pretty much lets them know that, Charlie lets them know that she's supposed to be meeting with Jacob Bordello, you know, about, you know, them transferring their 300 acres into one of the mills. And pretty much, you know, Jacob Bordelon pretty much runs a mill, and she's supposed to be meeting up with him to discuss, you know, business in regards to them turning over their sugar cane for profit. And the next thing you know, we hear Blue and Dollar in the background. All of a sudden, we see Aunt Vi's face turn up like, what the fuck is Dollar doing here? And then the next thing you know, we actually find out that Dollar is there to take Blue to school. And immediately, Aunt Vi was like, pump your brakes, Sister Kate. I normally take Blue to school every day. And then all of a sudden, Ralph Angel's like, oh man, Aunt Vi, I'm so sorry, I forgot. I told Dollar that she could take Blue to school today, and I'm sorry I didn't run that by you. So we can definitely see that Aunt Vi is pissed off because of this, because it's obvious that, you know, that Dollar is now back into the picture, and that now Ralph Angel is now taking on his role as being Blue's father, and, you know, Aunt Vi just feels like she's losing control, that she no longer has that grip. So we actually see her planting in her garden, Hollywood still being Hollywood, you know, is literally trying to smooth her over and, You know, he brings some flowers for her to plant into the garden. She's like, oh no, I don't want those. We're doing something different now. And he said that, look, like, yeah, it's messed up how the way things happen, but I never lied to you. I never lied to you of how I felt, and I'm not lying to you how I feel right now. And the next thing you know, he sits the pot down, and he just rolls off. And the next thing you know, she was about to finally start talking to him, but then he left. Because you can definitely tell she was trying to pay him dust or whatever. But he already knows what she's doing. So he kind of just sat the flowers down and left. And then she took one of the flowers and actually planted it in the garden. So I'm like, yeah, girl, stop playing hard to get. You know that man loves you. I understand that y'all still got some issues to work out, you know, involving trust. But you actually know that man really does care about you. And she knows that. And it's obvious she still cares about him. But it's going to be a process of them getting back to where they were. Next, we actually see that Ralph Angel comes to school to pick up Blue. He talks to Miss Velez, and let me tell you, there is some chemistry there between Miss Velez and Ralph Angel. I mean, personally, I think Darla still has feelings for Ralph Angel, and Ralph Angel still has feelings for her. But I think at this point, I think Ralph Angel is really, I don't think he's really feeling Darla in that way anymore, even though they had that, they pretty much had that situation a few episodes ago where he went to her trailer and he pretty much just served her Black D on the late night. But I think now I can definitely tell that him and Miss Velez, they got something there, and they still flirting back and forth. And she pretty much mentions that his class is going on a field trip to the zoo, and Blue's really excited. So Ralph Angel signs on the dotted line and says that, yeah, he can go on the field trip. I got you right here. So he signs it, and he picks up Blue, and then they leave. And then after that, Nova comes home. Tell me why damn Chantal got a damn room full of people from Black Lives Matter, because that's what Chantal is. Chantal's an activist. And Nova is as well, but Nova is more of a journalist, you know, and pretty much puts more of her activism in her work. Whereas, you know, Chantal is more of like a public speaking activist, where she holds rallies and, you know, leads marches and things like that. So homegirl Chantal got people up in Nova's house. They all sitting up there developing talking points and strategies for Nova's interview. Nova had to get into her ass and let her know, like, look, this is about, you know, me voicing my opinion about what's going on. You know, I understand you mean well, and I understand you want to help, but at the end of the day, it's going to be done my way, not yours. Then all of a sudden, we see that Miss Thing feels some kind of way. You know, Chantal's like, okay, everybody out, let's go. You know, everybody out, exit stage right, let's leave, let's go. And I'm like, girl, come on now. You kind of knew you were kind of on thin ice right there, because she already told you she had it, but yet you still wanted to inject yourself. And next thing you know, once everybody's leaving, Rick, who's a drug dealer who pretty much gets product from Nova, shows up, and he updates her about Too Sweet. And he lets her know that, look, you know, Too Sweet got into it with some of the people at the shelter, because he said it felt like prison, and this was during the last hurricane. But then since then, nobody knows where Too Sweet is. No one's seen his mom. You know, it's like Too Sweet has, like, disappeared. So because of that, you know, you can definitely tell that that Nova feels some kind of way, and we're going to see what's going to happen with that later on. Next, we actually see that Oh, yeah. Also, we actually see that Charlie is setting up her meeting with Jacob Bordalow, you know, with the who runs the mill. And while she's doing that, she gets a message from Gardini Prep, which is the school that Mike is supposed to go to. And they let her know that they want to meet with her and Davis on the account of Micah, because there's some situations involving him and his old school that they need to talk about. Meaning, you know, when an old girl's mom set him up with the whole dick pics and all of that shit. So, we actually see that Micah's dressed up, you know, for school or whatever, and Charlie lets him know what's going on, and definitely Micah's pissed off, because he's like, man, I'm trying to get a fresh start, and it's like, this shit is following me. And I'm biased, like, you know, fuck that school. Like, won't you just go to, like, won't you just go to St. Josephine High School? It's a good school. That's a school that, that Nova went to, and Nova got into college, and, you know, but then Charlie keeps on emphasizing that, you know, she wants her son to have a career, not just land a good job, and that he's very smart, and I want the best for him, which is pretty much known. But then all of a sudden, you know, she's saying that, you know, instead of spending all, like, a few thousand, you know, to send him to school, why don't you just send him to regular school? And then Michael's like, try $36,000 a year. And she's like, what the hell? She said, some people don't even make that a year. You know, you're spending that much for him to go to school? That's crazy. And she says, yes, and that's exactly why I want him to stay in private school. Which, in a way, kind of like, was taking a dig at Vi, because it's like, she's like, I couldn't even afford that. She's like, well, that's the reason why I got my son in private school. So, in a way, it kind of made Vi feel like, oh, bitch, you trying to shame me? Or because I'm a waitress? And because I don't have that kind of money? But she was like, oh, no, girl, it's okay. You know, if you want to keep spending all your money up on stuff, then go right ahead. It's your money. It's your prerogative. Do what you got to do. But you can definitely tell Charlie wasn't trying to take it there, but, you know, because Charlie's bougie, it comes off like very, you know, it comes off, you know, like this, you know, like this superiority complex when it comes to Charlie. You know, because she's so business-minded and she has, like, you know, strategies and she plans things. But sometimes when it comes down to matters of the family, she doesn't know when to get out of that realm. But you could also definitely tell that Michael was kind of pissed off by that, too. Because, like, in the way he was kind of putting down on Vi, you know, well, due to the fact that, you know, she's saying that, shoot, you know, well, no, actuality, it's like, she pretty much is now realizing that, okay, I really want Micah to go to this school, but then again, you know, we're going to have to deal with this head on. So she promised Micah she's going to get to the bottom of it. But yeah, it was kind of messed up, though, because, you know, that bougie side of Charlie does come out, and sometimes, because she's so used to it, she doesn't control it when it happens. Next, we actually see that Charlie and Jacob Bordalow, who pretty much runs the sugar mill, they meet up. He pretty much says that he wants 40% out of the profits of their sugar cane. He gives her a tour of the mill and tells her that she can make up to $400,000 plus after all is said and done. But they want pure sugar. They want the best of the cane. They don't want any cane that's lackluster. They want the best cane, and they want the best pure sugar quality. Okay, next we actually see Aunt Vi goes to the High Yellow, which is the diner that she used to work for. The High Yellow's been closed for days, and the reason why it's been closed for days is because they're going through health inspection. But Clyde, who's the owner, has no idea how to handle a health inspection. Aunt Vi comes in there and she knows everything. She knows where, you know, she knows where certain things are. She knows where the documents are. She knows how to handle the whole situation. So here it is. She was a waitress, but had managerial knowledge, but yet was being paid as a waitress. So I'm biased to her standards. She says that, look, I'll come back, but you're going to have to make me manager, which is going to give me a salary, and therefore I will pretty much run, pretty much will be the main person running the whole operation. And she and Clyde was like, no, I can't afford to give you no raise. Shoot, I don't even give my relatives raises when they work here. So, because you know that last dude who she got into it, who was the manager, who was really filming himself, that was Clyde's nephew. So, she was like, oh yeah, and the guy that played that role, that's actually Megan Good's cousin. I didn't mention that in my video, but I found that out. And I was like, because he did look familiar. But yeah, he got on my nerves, Mr. Sweet Tea. Yeah, Mr. Sweet Tea was getting on my nerves, and I wanted him to die a thousand deaths. But not enough about him. But all of a sudden, when Vi pretty much made her stand that she wanted to be manager, she wanted to raise, and then Clyde started to be like, well, I can't afford that. She's like, well, you know what, Clyde? Enjoy the rest of your day, and, you know, good luck with the health inspection. And he was like, okay, damn it, I'll hire you. So she got a raise, and she's now the manager of the store. So she comes in and starts talking to the health inspector, and everything worked out. So she's like, yeah, I'll come back, but I'm not coming back as a waitress. I'm too knowledgeable, and I know my shit, and I'm not going to just take something that's less than what I actually know. So I'm glad that Ambi made her stand and that she's now the new manager of the High Yellow. Big ups, Ambi. Big ups. Next, we also see that Ralph Angel comes to the school to pick up Blue, and he talks with Miss Velez, and Miss Velez lets him know that, look, I see that you signed his permission slip, but since you're not his legal guardian, this signature is denied. So your aunt is going to have to sign for Blue in order for him to go on this permission slip. And it really made Ralph Angel feel like that big. And it was actually sad. It was actually sad. Because here it is that he's active in his son's life. He's with his son every single day. But on paper, he's still not the actual legal guardian of his own son. So, and then to have this revelation revealed to you by his teacher, that definitely hit home for him. And next you actually see that, you know, he mentions this to Darla, you know, because Darla's there another day to take Blue to school, the next day to take Blue to school. He brings it up to Darla, and we actually can see that he's establishing a relationship with Darla, but you can definitely tell Darla wants more. You know, Darla wants Ralph Angel to fall in love with her again, but I'm not so sure Ralph Angel's there because he is flirting with Miss Velez as well. So we're going to see how that's going to play out, but I think it might be a love triangle involved with that situation. We just have to wait and see. And then next, you know, we also see him getting his hair cut by Hollywood, and he's talking to Hollywood about that, man, it makes me feel down in the dumps that this is my son, and I'm not even his legal guardian, and I'm trying to get on by to sign it, but I know she's not going to do it. She's not going to budge. So they have a conversation, and pretty much we can definitely see that Ralph Angel's at this point where he wants custody of his son, and he's going to confront on by. Next, you know, we also see that Charlie again meets with Jacob Bordello. She pretty much lets him know that they're going to go ahead with the deal with the 40-60, but in the back of her mind, she's even saying that this is a fucked up deal because even when she was a business manager, you know, as a sports manager, she said, we only take 5%. Why the hell are you guys taking 40? So she's putting that in her mind. But then again, Jacob, being the conniving bastard he is, shows her a map of where their farm is, and it shows that Landry's, that that the Landry family, as well as the Bordello family, owns land all around theirs. So he pretty much saying that he wants to make her an offer that she can't refuse. The question is, what is that offer, and what is their intentions as to why they're making that offer? But we're gonna get, I'm definitely gonna get to that. Next thing you know, we have the situation with Aunt Vi and Ralph Angel. Ralph Angel gets her to sign Blue's permission slip because it's null and void because he's not the legal guardian, but Aunt Vi is. Next thing you know, he signs it, and next thing you know, she signs it, and you know, you definitely see Ralph Angel unravel, where to the point he said that, and to the point he pretty much let it be known, like, why won't you let me have custody of my own son? And then he had brought up that conversation that she had had with Charlie, because after the school had told Charlie that she needs to bring Davis there, and both of them need to go meet with the new school, Gardini Prep, I think. And she does tell Charlie that, look, you know, regardless of the fact that I can't stand Davis and the way you feel about Davis, that's still Micah's father, and he has a right to be in his life, and he does have his rights as his father. So Ralph Angel brought that up to Aunt Vi and was like, look, you said that to Charlie. How come that doesn't apply to me? You know, I'm his father. I'm with him every single day. How do you think it makes me feel that I don't have rights to my own son? That when it comes down to making actual decisions for my son's behalf, I can't do it because I don't have custody of my son. But then he said that, look, no one's going to take away from what you've done. You know, you held Blue after Darla had her situation, after I was locked up. You were there for Blue, and you protected Blue, you and Hollywood, and I will forever be grateful for that. But now I need to be the father that I know I'm meant to be, and that I want to be able to take that. I want to be able to have my power as his father over his life. So she finally caves in, and she actually signs that that form that he had brought to her before, which actually gives, you know, the parental rights of Blue back to him. So, and we actually saw that, you know, Ralph Angel was crying. He broke down because he really wants to be a father to his son. And I'm glad that finally Aunt Vi finally let go and decided to give him back the rights to his son. So that was everything. Next, we actually see Aunt Vi, you know, is back at work as the manager. We see Roberta's old slutty ass, and, you know, she all turned up. She's like, and she's like, Roberta? I love me some Aunt Vi, but then she pretty much is getting things set up. Hollywood comes in and congratulates her on her promotion, and, you know, at first she's not really talking. And then he pretty much says that, yeah, I just wanted to come and say, just check up on you and let you know congratulations on your new position. He's about to walk away, and she's like, I got some fresh coffee for you. So he sits down, and she makes him a cup of coffee, and you can definitely tell that the ice is starting to break between the two of them, where that genuine connection that they had is starting to come back again. And it's good that tension is starting to wear off and that they're starting to get close again. Next thing you know, we actually see that Chantal and Nova breaks up. But then again, you know, Nova's like, so why are you all in your feelings? Are you in your feelings because I won't let you be involved in this article? She's like, oh, no, it ain't that. It's the fact that when I was going through your stuff, I saw pictures of this white man, you know, who so happens to be a cop on a racist police force. So you was involved with a married man, and not only that, you're involved with a married white man who's a cop. and who's a part of a racist police force. Like, what the hell is going on, Nova? It's kind of like you just like a walking contradiction. And then Nova's like, look, I'm attracted to the person. You know, that's what I was attracted to. It had nothing to do with him being a cop or him being white or anything. It was him that I was attracted to. And it's no different than the way I was attracted to you. And pretty much it was like, okay, she somewhat gets where Nova's coming from, but then again, it's like she's kind of just, in a way, kind of turned off by the whole situation. So we pretty much see that, you know, Chantal went and got her stuff, and, you know, she went on about her business, because Chantal's like, she's done. And she's like, maybe we just reached the end of to where, as far as we're going to go. Maybe what I thought we had, maybe it's not as strong as I thought so. So, but then again, it was kind of messed up that they broke up. But then again, you know, it's for the best. You know, it is what it is. And then next, pretty much how it ends is that Charlie calls a meeting with the whole family. Proc is there, Vi's there, Nova's there, as well as Ralph Angel. And she kind of puts everything together. Because even before, after she met with Jacob Bordello, she had talked to Aunt Vi, and Aunt Vi kind of let her know about the Landrys and the Bordellos, and that they own all the mills within St. Josephine. Is that, and she pretty much made the comment that, look, it's their world and we just surviving in it. Pretty much kind of like letting her know that this is racism, white supremacy, you know, all across the board. They control everything. So if they control the main, you know, manufacturing of the sugar cane, how are you going to really turn a profit? And next thing you know, Charlie lets them know that they offered her, that Jacob Bordellon made her an offer that was double than what Sam Landry was offering. And she's saying that, why is it that they both are trying to take this land? But then it also comes to know that both of the families are actually related. You know, the Landrys and the Bordellos. So she's saying that, how come they never didn't mention this beforehand? What is their aim? What is their goal? And from that, Proctor and Aunt Vi begins to tell them the story of the history of their family in relation to the Landrys and the Bordellos. And she lets it be known that at one point, the land that they owned was a part of the Bordellos. It was their land. And their family, you know, the Bordellos, they were sharecroppers on the land. And before that, they were slaves. So therefore, the Bordellos actually owned them. So probably, in all actuality, they're probably related to the Bordellos, because I'm pretty sure the Bordellos was having their way with the slaves. You know, no tea, no shade. It is what it is. We already know the history. So, we know the history of some of the practices of slavery. That's what I meant. Well, according to them, they said that during, I think, like the crash of 29 and the Great Depression, the Bordellos family lost a lot of money, and one of the Bordellos, one of the members of their family, actually bought the land that they now own. And they went through all of these great measures to get that land back from the Bordellos family. But, you know, because at first they were saying that they couldn't actually find the deed, so it wasn't actual, but then later on that deed turned up. So it's true that the Bordellos actually own that land now. And that's what the Bordellos and the Landrys, they want that land back. So from that point on, they have done nothing but create hell. You know, they even killed Ernest and Aunt Vi's father. You know, he pretty much died protecting that land. And they said that for years they have done all kind of things like torturing, brutalizing, all kind of things to our family to get us to give up that land back to the Bordellos. And then she also brought up their father, Ernest. They said that, yeah, they really came after Ernest. So in all actuality, that stroke he had, they killed him because they brought that about. They put that man through so much stress, but he was not going to give that up because he knows the history of what our family had to go through to get that land, and he was not going to let them get that land back. Next thing you know, we actually see Charlie, Nova, and Ralph Angel. They're looking out into the land, and she's saying that this land has been paid for, and we ain't going nowhere. So that's my review for Queen Sugar. Subscribe to my channel, like this video, share this video, leave comments on this video. I truly appreciate your feedback, and I thank you for your support. But share this video, and I will definitely be back next week with another episode of Queen Sugar. It's been a pleasure, guys. I really did enjoy this episode because this episode put a lot together, and man, them damn Landry's and them damn Bordelos, they some crooked motherfuckers, but we really see, you know, the real art of racism, white supremacy, and how it really plays its role onto black life. So definitely continue to tune in to my channel, and I will be back with you guys next week. So until then, take care.